alleviate neurodegenerative diseases, we will hear now from Dr. Renana Eitan another option, how to do it. Renana Eitan is from the Department of Psychiatry of the Hebrew University and, again, Hadassah Medical School here in Jerusalem, and she will speak about the effects of deep brain stimulation treatment on personality of patients. Please go on.
Thank you. Okay, so start like this. Deep brain stimulation, which I'll refer to as DBS, is the most area-specific method for stimulating the human brain. DBS uses an implanted electrode to deliver electrical stimulation to specific brain structures. While DBS is an improved therapy for severe medication refractory movement disorders, it remains investigational in neuropsychiatry. However, experience to date, although limited, suggests that DBS may offer a degree of hope for individuals with severe treatment-resistant neuropsychiatric illnesses. Thus far, work in obsessive-compulsive disorder, the first psychiatric condition studied using modern DBS devices, has shown consistently positive results across multiple small-scale studies. Work in treatment-resistant depression also suggests therapeutic potential in preliminary studies, generating cautious optimism for this indication. With the increase in potential applications, a number of clinical and preclinical research efforts have now focused on understanding the mechanisms of actions of DBS. Given its history, neurosurgical intervention for mental disorders is a socially and culturally sensitive area of research and practice. In the next couple of minutes, I will firstly ask whether DBS differs from other psychotherapeutic methods. Secondly, I will discuss the willingness and competence of psychiatric patients to consent to DBS research. Then, I will review the use of DBS in depression and obsessive-compulsive disorder. And finally, I will review our experience in psychiatric aspects and ethical issues in DBS in Parkinson's patients. Treatment of patients with psychiatric disorder is directed towards several goals. First, the patient's safety must be guaranteed. Second, a complete diagnostic evaluation of the patient is necessary. Third, a treatment plan should address not only the immediate symptoms, but also the patient's prospective well-being. The objective of treatment is symptom remission, not just symptom reduction. Patients with residual symptoms, as opposed to full remission, are more likely to experience a relapse or recurrence of episodes and to experience ongoing impairment of daily functioning. The first treatment approach is based on either pharmacotherapy or psychotherapy alone. However, most studies indicate, and most clinicians believe, that a combination of both is most effective in treatment of psychiatric disorders. In moderate to severe cases, pharmacotherapy is always initiated, and it is generally effective in about two-thirds of patients. Brain stimulation modalities are reserved for treatment-resistant disorders. The most investigated form of brain stimulation is electroconvulsive therapy, another treatment for extremely refractory patients was traditionally ablative surgery therapy. The first question about DBS, which I consider a comparatively easy one, regards the potential personality changes due to this treatment. The ethical dilemma arose together with the introduction of the first neuromodulating drugs, but in the past 60 years, most clinicians perceived psychiatric pharmacological treatments as relieving significant psychic pain without causing personality changes. Any treatment in this sense affects the course of a chronic mental disorder and therefore could manipulate mental processes and behavior patterns. Prescribing fluoxetine, known as Prozac, to healthy people neither makes them happier nor changes their personality. In a similar way, intensive researches of electroconvulsive therapy do not indicate any personality changes due to brain stimulation. In a recently published study, no personality changes were found in Parkinson's patient 1 year after undergoing DBS. To make things simple, existing methods treat mental diseases but do not cause personality changes. To make things complicated again, I do not exclude the future possibility of identifying specific brain areas controlling personality traits, such as impulsivity or narcissism. Using DBS as a suitable treatment in those cases might re-arouse the ethical dilemma. But for now, I will stick to our existing clinical knowledge. The second question about DBS regards potential side effects. Current psychiatric medication can cause side effects such as metabolic and hormonal changes, sexual dysfunctions, and uncontrollable movements. Although most of these side effects disappear when the meds are taken off, some of these side effects are irreversible. The most serious side effects of electroconvulsive therapy are cognitive decline and cardiac arrest during the treatment. Surgical implantation of DBS systems is invasive and thus not a minimal risk procedure. Infections, hemorrhage, and other common surgical complications are reported. As operative risks are greater in more vascular regions, DBS demands careful consideration of potential adverse effects. Having said that, and in contrast to lesion-in approaches, DBS does have the clinical and ethical advantages of being potentially reversible, except for the serious adverse effects related to surgery. In contrast to lesioning, DBS is non-ablative and with the advantages of reversibility and adjustability. Thus, therapeutic effectiveness can be enhanced and stimulation-related side effects minimized during long-term patient management. A more disturbing ethical dilemma is related to the introduction of new methods and protocols of treatment. Respect for the safety of human subjects is an ethical obligation in all areas of biomedical research. However, psychiatric research has received disproportionate attention from the regulatory bodies, perhaps because of the news media. The main concern is, of course, that people suffering from mental disorders are at higher risk of exploitation due to possible lack of decision-making capacity. The full picture is a bit more complicated. It should be remembered that additional regulation and safeguards for research involving the mentally ill reinforces social stigma about the mental illness, is impractical and expensive, and most important, could impede psychiatric research. Truly, several mental illnesses may prevent some individuals from adequately understanding the risks that they are assuming when entering into research protocols, or from rationally weighting potential risks against potential benefits. However, a recent important study by Bruce Cohen and colleagues investigated the willingness of psychiatric patients to volunteer for research and their capacity to consent and to distinguish between protocols offering different levels of risk and benefit. The findings clearly demonstrate that while patients with schizophrenia are lacking in their decision-making capacities, patients with depression showed the same ability as mentally healthy people and were able to distinguish levels of risk between different treatment options. In other words, most individuals with mental disorder retain the capacity to make sensitive choices with regard to research participation. Considering the above data, I believe that ethical regulation for DBS treatment in depression or obsessive-compulsive disorder should not be different from those for other DBS treatment, as, for example, in Parkinson's disease. Obviously, future research on other mental diseases should be regarded according to the specific characters of each disease. In the next few minutes, I will dig a little bit deeper into the research frontiers of using DBS in neuropsychiatry, especially depression, OCD, and psychiatric aspects of Parkinson's disease. One challenge facing the use of DBS for mental disorders is the identification of the appropriate anatomic site for stimulation. With the increase in potential applications, a number of clinical and preclinical research efforts have now focused on understanding the mechanisms of the actions of DBS. Integration of behavioral studies and brain science has led to the idea that our mental state is not unified, but rather is divided into many subfunctions. Identifying mental subfunctions is a complex issue. Behavior is thought to be a reflection of the mental state, but objective quantification of behavior is difficult. For example, mood is a pervasive and sustained feeling tone that is expressed internally. The mood influences a person's behavior and perception of the world and can be normal, elevated, or depressed. Healthy persons experience a wide range of moods and have an equally large repertoire of affective expressions. To answer a simple question such as, how do you feel today, one must have some self-identity, the ability to identify his external experience and to externalize his feelings using basic social skills or language. Recent knowledge indicates that all higher functions such as cognition, perception, motion, language, thought, and memory are related to interactions between specific mechanisms in different areas of the brain. The normal mental function is based on numerous neural circuits that create a unified mental experience. To make a long story short, the ability to smile and answer, "I'm very happy today," involves many elementary processing operations. However, not everyone is very happy today. Results from the Israel National Health Survey, published in 2007, show that almost one in five respondents reported a lifetime occurrence of a mood or anxiety disorder, while nearly one in 10 adults reported a mood or anxiety disorder in the previous 12 months. It should be noted that according to the World Health Organization data, depression is one of the leading causes of disability worldwide. I would like to describe to you a classic case of depression. Anna O addressed my office about 6 years ago. She was an impressive old lady, about 75 years old. She emigrated from Poland after the Second World War and worked as a nurse for many years. She was hospitalized in the psychiatric department due to severe depression for about 6 months. She complained about depressed mood, crying most of the day, loss of interest in or pleasure in almost any activity, feelings of guilt that her family must take care of her, and feeling of low self-esteem. She complained that she couldn't sleep more than 3 hours a day and mentioned that her appetite has decreased and she lost over 10 kilograms of her weight. She found it hard to concentrate and was not able to follow her favorite TV show. She gradually stopped doing her regular household chores and refused to meet with any friends or family members, even her grandchildren. This is a common presentation of depression that emphasizes the emotional misery that comes in addition to the actual depressive symptoms and the interpersonal dysfunctionality. Depression occurs in persons of all genders, ages, and backgrounds, can become chronic and lead to substantial impairment in the individual's ability to take care of her everyday responsibilities. At its worst, depression can lead to recurrent thoughts about death and suicide. Antidepressant medication and many forms of psychotherapy are effective for about two-thirds of those affected. Unfortunately, even the best pharmacological and psychological interventions do not help all patients, so they become what we consider treatment-resistant patients. The next step in treatment-resistant depression is brain stimulation. The most common treatment is electroconvulsive therapy that is effective in about half of these patients. Anna went through a regular ECT protocol, but although the depressive symptoms gradually improved, she rapidly developed severe cognitive decline and the ECT was terminated. A few days later, the cognitive state returned to baseline, but her mental state deteriorated rapidly. She reported recurrent thoughts about death. Anna smelled smoke in the psychiatric ward and was convinced that her grandchildren, who lived in another city, were on fire. Such psychotic symptoms and death ideations are the most serious complication of depression. Anna's physical examination was normal. She gradually revealed important facts from her past. She was born in a Polish Catholic family. During the war, her parents helped a Jewish family hide in their house. Some soldiers found the Jewish people and burned her father and older brother in the street while she was witnessing this horrible situation. After the war, she met a Jewish man and decided to marry him, and they came to Israel. As Anna's mental state became worse, I consulted my colleagues about using a new ECT device that can give more focused brain stimulation. Using the new ECT device in a modified protocol for the first time in Israel, Anna's depressive and psychotic symptoms recovered without any cognitive decline. Anna's story emphasizes the importance of brain stimulation in treatment-resistant depression. In order to minimize cognitive side effects, we have improved and modified the ECT device and protocol, making the treatment more physiologically focused. Up to date, I've treated over 70 patients. According to my experience, this method helps about half of the patients. This is the reason for efforts to progress and develop new brain stimulation modalities. In the past 10 years, new modalities for brain stimulation became available in research protocols. These techniques include transcranial magnetic stimulation and vagal nerve stimulation. Great hopes were riding on these brain stimulation techniques as an alternative to electroconvulsive therapy. However, the effects in the controlled trials were mostly so weak that doubt has been cast on their clinical relevance. 5 years ago, the first patient was treated with DBS for depression. DBS deploys an implanted electrode to deliver electrical stimulation to specific brain structures. The challenge is, however, to find the appropriate circuits of effect. The published experience is small and is divided into two anatomical sites. Maber and her colleagues described 20 patients stimulated at the subganglial cingulate region, Brodmann area 25. Schlaufer and his colleagues described 3 patients stimulated at the nucleus accumbens, and Malone and his colleagues have recently described 15 patients stimulated at the ventral striatum. When I first explored the literature, I was very surprised to find out that opposed to other investigational protocols, the identification of the anatomic site for stimulation was not based on preliminary animal studies. Rather, it was based entirely on functional neuroimaging of humans in order to identify putative stimulation sites for depression. Truly, our ability to model depression in animals is complicated since it is a primarily mental disease, but the history of research of DBS, especially in Parkinson's disease, did go successfully through the regular process of animal studies as a preliminary step for protocol application. The reported remission rate was about 40%, a relatively high rate for severe treatment-resistant depression. These are very impressive ratios, which certainly encourage us to enhance the efforts for wider-scale research on those specific brain areas while continuing the research for additional targets. Before I continue to describing my current research frontier, a few words about OCD, the most studied indication of psychiatric DBS. An obsession is a recurrent and intrusive thought, feeling, idea, or sensation. In contrast to an obsession, which is a mental event, a compulsion is a behavior. Specifically, a compulsion is a conscious, recurrent behavior such as counting, checking, or avoiding. A patient with OCD realizes the irrationality of the obsession and experiences both the obsessions and compulsions as unwanted behavior. Although the compulsive act may carry out in an attempt to reduce the anxiety associated with the obsession, it does not always succeed in doing so. The completion of a compulsive act may not affect the anxiety, and it may even increase the anxiety. Anxiety is also increased when a person resists carrying out a compulsion. These recurrent obsessions or compulsions cause severe distress to the person. The obsessions or compulsions are time-consuming and interfere significantly with a person's normal routine, occupational functioning, usual social activities, or relationships. Onset commonly occurs before adulthood and tends to be chronic. Conventional treatments for OCD are cognitive behavior therapy and medications, particularly serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Since the first report in 2003, over 100 individuals with treatment-resistant OCD have had DBS surgery. Last February, the American FDA granted limited humanitarian approval for DBS of the anterior lip of the internal capsule for otherwise intractable OCD, the first such approval for a psychiatric illness. I want now to add another multidisciplinary layer to the involvement of psychiatry in DBS treatment. By this, I refer to my current work regarding the identification and treatment of mental aspects of DBS in Parkinson's disease. Parkinson is a neurodegenerative disorder characterized by disabling motor symptoms as well as psychopathological syndromes, including affective disorder, psychotic symptoms, cognitive deterioration, and perceptual and behavioral symptoms. DBS of the subthalamic nucleus, or the globus pallidus internus, is an effective treatment of motor symptoms in Parkinson's disease, but increases their quality of life. However, it has been reported that DBS might also cause significant adverse cognitive and mental effects. With my colleagues at Hadassah Medical Center, we try to improve and research treatment with DBS so it can affect neurological and the mental symptoms of Parkinson's disease. For example, one of our patients developed a severe psychotic state 2 weeks after the surgery. She called me one night asking many questions about the operation procedure, but I felt that something else was bothering her. I asked her to come to the hospital the next morning. The neurologist set up the stimulation and reported that she is perfectly treated from his point of view. Later, I examined her and found that she had severe delusional thoughts about the surgery. She was convinced that during the surgery, the doctors implanted some brain tissue from another patient into her brain, and she was infected with HIV. She was agitated, frightened, and she asked me whether she can simply take it away, pointing on her implanted pacemaker. This case emphasizes, first and foremost, the need for a careful combined neurological and psychiatric follow-up after the stimulation in these patients. Sometimes depression, anxiety, or psychosis are not identified by a regular neurological examination, while these mental symptoms have major influence on the well-being of the patient and in extreme cases might result in irreversible consequences such as self-harm. Secondly, we focus on stimulation of the subthalamic nucleus. The subthalamic nucleus can be divided into three functional territories: a sensory motor area, a limbic area, and a cognitive associative area. The sensory motor region of the STM, is primarily located dorsolaterally, the same location that seems to provide optimal control of the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. Our working hypothesis is that existing methods of adjustment of DBS parameter aim at stimulation of the subthalamic nucleus motor territory only. Therefore, we propose that increasing the DBS affected volume to include the cognitive and limbic territories of the subthalamic nucleus might result in improvement in these domains of Parkinson's patient. This study is going on, and with a special attention to the cognitive and mental status of the patients, we have noticed several interesting findings. For example, one patient developed a severe cognitive decline over a two-year period despite a significant improvement in his motor function. When the stimulation was turned off, his cognitive function improved significantly, but unfortunately his motor function deteriorated. Another example is two female patients that experienced a clinically relevant worsening of depressive symptoms during the first month following the operation. Although both patients achieved a significant improvement of their motor symptoms, their total quality of life decreased due to severe sadness, anhedonia, loss of energy, and loss of interest in all activities. They were treated and experienced a full recovery of their depressive symptoms, as well as a consistent improvement of their motor symptoms. However, one of the patients reported that she had suffered severe depressive episodes in the past, but did not report the history before the DBS surgery because she was afraid to be rejected from the DBS surgery. Suicide attempts are among the most life-threatening adverse effects of DBS. One of our patients attempted suicide while developing a severe combination of mental changes and cognitive decline. She was a talented pianist before she developed Parkinson's disease. She had a history of one major depressive episode and a general anxiety disorder for many years and a mild cognitive decline before surgery. The DBS stimulation had good results on her motor symptoms, but 14 months after the surgery, she developed a severe depressive episode with marked anxiety and with marked anxiety symptoms. She was treated with antidepressants, anxiolytics, and antipsychotics, but nevertheless developed severe agitation, attempted suicide, and was hospitalized in our psychiatric department. The stimulation was turned off for 5 days. During these days, there was no change in her mental state, but she did develop severe motor symptoms, and so the stimulation was turned back on. Despite relative high dose of psychiatric medications, her mental state was rapidly deteriorating with catatonic-like symptoms, including severe psychomotor agitation necessitating physical restraint and psychomotor retardation with the refusal to eat and speak. She constantly reported depressed mood and suicidal ideation, but had no delusions or hallucinations. During her stay, she developed significant cognitive decline with difficulties in orientation, calculation, language, attention, and frontal and executive functions. After 2 months and a washout period of all her medication, DOPA and dopamine agonists were started with gradual improvement in her mental and cognitive status. After being released from the ward, she called me and said she can once again enjoy Chopin's masterpieces. Suicide attempts and completed suicide are among the most troublesome effects of DBS. Suicide results from a complex interaction of biological, psychological, sociological, environmental, and cultural factors. Some of the mental risk factors of suicide include depression, psychosis, lack of impulse control, and poor coping skills. The reported suicide rate in DBS-treated Parkinson's patients ranged from 0.5% to 4.3%. Most of these patients were young men who had episodes of severe depression before and during the course of the disease prior to DBS. Most interestingly, all these patients benefited from considerable functional improvement as a result of DBS. However, it should be noted that the rate of suicide after DBS is actually equal to that of a non-DBS-treated patient's Parkinson's patients. The analysis of these individuals' outcomes emphasizes the need for a detailed evaluation before the surgery, as well as careful combined neurological and psychiatric follow-up after the stimulation in these patients. Patients with cognitive decline should be carefully evaluated before the surgery. Untreated depression, anxiety, or psychosis should be treated before the surgery. However, a new dilemma has risen in our team. Is it scientifically and ethically appropriate to reject Parkinsonian patients who developed depression or anxiety in the past? When I retrospectively checked all the records of over 150 patients who were operated in our center in the last 5 years, I found out that almost half of them were treated with antidepressants or anxiolytics, and some of them were treated with antipsychotics. Most of them did not develop psychiatric complication after the surgery. In addition, rejecting patients who developed mental illness in the past may cause a deliberate hiding of depression or anxiety symptoms by the patients. To answer our dilemma, we are trying to establish a team that will discuss the suitability of the candidates for this procedure. We try not to discriminate those who suffer mental illnesses. With the exception of severe mental disorders, we believe that we can treat patients who develop depression or anxiety in the past. Together with that, our main research aim is to treat both the motor and mental symptoms of Parkinson's disease by subthalamic nucleus DBS and try to give new hope for these patients. To sum up, DBS is a relatively new and exciting method which calls for further research and brings new hope for severe physically and mentally ill patients. As any new protocol, it should be performed cautiously, especially considering the potential vulnerability of mentally ill patients. The consent process should include discussion of what is and is not known about short and long-term consequences of DBS. awareness and sensitivity to the moral and ethical dilemmas, together with cooperation of experts from various disciplines and research centers, are a precondition for successful implementation of this almost science fiction method. I wish to thank my colleagues from Hadassah Medical Center, especially Chagai Bergman. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you very clearly could show us that even exciting and new technology that is not so much debated because it has such a lot of use for the patients has its problems and needs further development and further research. The paper is open, the talk is open for discussion. If there is no question, I have a question. Do you think that besides studying or examining the patients for mental problems, we also need some technological development of the devices, of the DBS devices?
Yes, of course, but I'm a psychiatrist. I don't do development.
Yeah, but you did not notice differences in different technology devices of any art, no? Okay.
This is the main concern of my study group, and I must say that my focus is not the technological improvements.
Okay. Thank you very much. We have heard a lot about our brain.